Now I will give the floor to Mr. Shen Wang, Professor of Biosystem Engineering at the University College Dublin, that will give us the picture of the food waste in Europe, presenting the global framework within which the project has taken place. Shen, I will leave you the floor.
Thank you very much for inviting me here to present to this conference. I want to take a global perspective to essentially set the scene in relation to this particular challenge. And it is a global challenge. And I think, Secretary General Plaza, you encapsulated the extent of the challenge. And I would like to highlight, before I start, 3 points that you made. One, that it's global. And on the one hand, you have an abundance and waste, meaning in the Western world. And on the other side, you have scarcity on the other. The second point is that something in the region of a third of food is wasted. And the next point is that there is a need for sustainable agricultural systems. So I think, Secretary General, you did encapsulate the extent of this challenge. And with that in mind then, I'm going to present my perspective, looking at global and local. And I come from a background whereby we have just completed the leadership of a project called AgroCycle. You can see the website here. And that addressed, it was a Horizon 2020 European Commission funded project addressing the application of the circular economy across the agri-food sector. Looking at food waste, it is a major challenge. And the largest single contributor in Western Europe is the household. And the household, it is everybody, the citizens, every citizen, everybody attending this particular conference. So the opportunity to reduce and reduce waste and address this problem rests with us. We are the most powerful body, as it were, that can contribute significantly to addressing this problem. I now just want to outline the premise on which I present this overall perspective. First of all, that the primary role of agriculture is to produce food, not to produce energy. Now, I know this conflicts with certain people's perspective, but if you look at the global demand and requirement for food, not just now, but into the future, then the primary role of agriculture has to be to produce food. And food policy cannot be addressed properly on what I describe as a fortress Europe basis. A global perspective is essential because neither the atmosphere nor trade does actually respect borders. You cannot ring fence environmental or economic dynamics within borders. And the overall concept must be to produce more food using less resources and the waste not, want not concept. One important point is that you cannot assume that if a waste is used, then the system is in some way more sustainable. Now, sustainable is a very important aspect of this. And you require these techniques, the so-called life cycle assessment, looking at the full impact of a particular initiative across the full life cycle from cradle to grave. And another key element is what I describe as the consumer pays principle. In other words, that you assign the true burden to the end user, that is the consumer, not the producer. And we'll speak more about this presently. But this is analogous to the long established polluter pays principle. Now, if you look at food, you really need to look not just at the food commodity itself, but also the resources that were used to produce that food. And if you do that, This would include, for example, water, fertilizer, soil, energy, and others. If you do that, you have to take an integrated perspective, a holistic view. And that completely changes the way you look on food. This schematic from the AgroCycle project, I think, summarizes the overall concept. It takes a holistic view. And here you have to look at food in the concept of a full chain from farm to fork. In other words, from production on the farm right through to the consumer and beyond. So here you have the farm, you have processing plants, retail, and then there's a move in recent years to build a bioeconomy on top of this agri-food sector. And that is something, again, I'll speak about presently. But the key driver of this system is the citizen, the consumer. And this system must be in dynamic balance. Here is an example of a near-perfect sustainable agri-food system based on a circular economy. Now, the circular economy is essentially that one looks at sustainable systems whereby resources are used efficiently and circulated where possible. This one will be well known to people in the UK, in Ireland, maybe not as well known in continental Europe, the so-called Norfolk four-course rotation. Norfolk is a county in England, and this system was in vogue across the British Isles right up to the early part of the 20th century. At that stage, bear in mind that the world population was 1.5 million, just slightly larger than the current population of India. Most trade was local, and this system enabled food supply to be addressed on a local basis. There were no artificial fertilizers, carbon levels in soils were sustained, and what's needed now is a 21st century version of this Norfolk four-course rotation to stabilize soil carbon, which is a huge issue, and to ensure food production for the future. The concept of local versus global. In the 19th century, local could provide the needs of mankind. Remember, the population was just a little bit larger than that of the current India. But now food production is global, and you simply cannot provide the needs of mankind on a local basis. So that's a very important point. And if you look at how dramatic the demand for resources has increased in recent times, in 1950, the population of the world was only about 2.5 billion. So it has almost trebled since then. That is huge. And the other issue that has arisen, that back in the 1950s, lifestyle was frugal. It is far from frugal in the Western world now. So the challenge is bigger than you think. You will hear about the population increasing by 50% by 2050, maybe hitting 10 billion or whatever. But in fact, the global impact will quadruple simply because the Western world lifestyle is the aspiration of everybody. And with that goes increased consumption of resources. So what's now 6 billion, what I describe as resource units, by 2030, it will have doubled. That's only less than a decade away. And by 2050, it will have quadrupled approximately. So the point is that we really have an issue here in relation to the use of resources and avoiding waste. Now, food waste occurs across the complete chain, and it is driven by the consumer. I harp back on this. The citizen, the consumer, is the key to all of this. But in the statistics that are quoted, on-farm production is generally ignored. Now, what I mean by this is on-farm operational inefficiencies and, for example, contractual issues between the customer, which may be a retailer, and the farmer. A farmer may have to reject some food that he has produced, some produce, simply because the retailer may not be in a position to purchase it because it doesn't meet a particular standard. That's a huge issue. The retail business valorization pathways and in the home, and the citizen is the key driver from, on the basis of consumer demand and behavior. The concept of a market for waste, this is quite a sort of a catch-22 situation. A market for waste reduces what I describe as pressure on the need for efficiency. So in implementing a circular economy approach, there is a real danger of generating a market for waste streams, thereby reducing the pressure on primary producers to be efficient and on consumers to reduce food waste. We'll speak more about that later, but here's a key thing. The so-called Jevons rebound effect, and this arises from what I describe as the problem-solved scenario. This is where consumers consider that the need for reducing food waste has been overcome by alternative uses for discarded food. For example, redistribution organizations, valorization pathways. So for example, if a consumer thinks that their waste is going to be used to produce perhaps energy, then they may say, well, I don't need to be too careful about food waste. So if I do waste food, not to worry, it's going to be used for some useful purpose. And this is further exacerbated during periods of increasing economic growth, where the relative cost of food decreases and the demand expectations of the consumer increase. So if you look at this, that is not a technical issue. That is a human behavior issue, and that's the key driver. So technical solutions may in theory resolve issues. In practice, it is the way the consumer operates and thinks that that is important. So this here gives you an example of the Jevons effect, where you have, as we described earlier, production on the farm, retail, consumer, and a bioeconomy built on this. If you build a bioeconomy on top of the agri-food sector, meaning that this bioeconomy valorizes waste emerging from the agri-food sector, that bioeconomy can pull food waste out of the system. In other words, it creates a market for waste. And as such, it reduces, potentially reduces, consumers' concern regarding waste. So these things are never clear-cut, and that's a huge issue. You may end up that a bioeconomy puts, as we say in English, the cart before the horse, or in this case, that's a famous ad from Guinness, being Irish, where the farmer, if you drink plenty of Guinness, you're as strong as a horse. This graph here, I think, summarizes this. If you look at an inefficient system, this is volume of waste and this is value of the waste. So generally speaking, production systems that are inefficient are in section two here, where you have a lot of waste and it's worth very little. So what you really need to do is you need to move to the left. In other words, reduce the amount of waste to get into that zone, but of course it's of low value. Now, if you get to that point, then you may well say, if it's of low value, can I find a market for this waste so that at least this waste, which is unavoidable, can I find an outlet for it that will increase my income? And therefore one tends to move up to section three. But what happens en route to that is, when you get to section three, you then begin to say, I have a nice market for this particular produce, but if I could get more waste, I could make more money. So inevitably what happens is the move goes towards section four, where you have, again, you've gone back to the situation where you're producing a lot of waste, but now you're getting more money for it. And that defeats the concept of reducing waste. So it's a vicious circle. So if you look at the bioeconomy and alternative food uses, you need to treat them with caution. An agri-food-based bioeconomy should only be built on unavoidable agri-food waste. And a bioeconomy, because it creates a market for waste, you run the danger of the system becoming a generator of waste. And inefficiencies and associated waste can be exacerbated rather than reduced. Another key issue on a global scale is environmental burden shifting. And the impact of global trade and food are widespread. And when a country imports food, the environmental burdens are effectively shifted abroad and borne by the primary producer in a distant country. So if a country imported all its food, that country would appear to have zero environmental impact arising from the production of food it consumes. Now that's complete nonsense, but that's the way things are accounted for at present. So if you look at this on a global scale, the old idea that if a butterfly flaps its wings in one place, it has a domino effect right around the globe. So environmental systems are global. Global agri-food industry and the atmosphere and economics cannot be ring-fenced. So the question arises, who pays? If the world wants beef, is it the beef-producing countries that take all the environmental burden, or is it the consumer? So I'm asking that question. And who produces? If the world wants wine, it makes sense to produce this wine in what one would describe as a wine country, such as Spain, the Mediterranean, obviously not in Ireland. So the concept of zones in the world where it's appropriate to produce food, where it can be produced more efficiently than others, makes perfect sense. So the concept that the consumer pays principle, which I raised earlier, applies to this. And if you look at the global trade in food and agri-food resources, it's truly extensive. Growing locally may not be the most environmentally sustainable option, but there is a limited market demand for it. So what I would caution the concept that growing locally is always the best option. In fact, the reality is that you could not feed the world based on growing locally. You could do that in the 19th century. You cannot do it now. The consumer is king. Solutions to environmental impacts of agri-food sector are mainly non-technical. The system is driven by the consumer demand. Society has to adapt to the challenges of socioeconomic, education, behavior, lifestyle, global approach. And this is an example arising from the AgroCycle project, where we purposely included a program to educate the future generation, to enhance awareness among citizens. You can look at the website here, AgroCycle Kids. It's managed by a university in Ireland, Maynooth University, contact details there. The concept is you start young, you embed the whole concept in the primary education system. It has a long-term impact. And we would claim that it has far greater impact than any technological solution, because technological solutions are only as good as those who use them, which of course is the citizen. Policy. The old saying, the pen is mightier than the sword, applies here. Policy is a very powerful tool, can be implemented at the stroke of a pen, highly impactful. You can get instantaneous impacts, but bad policy is very dangerous. And a lot of damage has been done by poorly thought out policy. So the warning here is to be very careful in relation to policy. And it is, in fairness, very difficult to envisage all impacts of policy. But there are numerous cases of policy that have caused more damage than good. Another concept in relation to farming systems, and was alluded to by the Secretary General, the concept of sustainable agricultural systems. And efficiency at farm level is very important. So in economics, there is this concept of opportunity cost. In other words, if you didn't do this, what would the alternative costs be? And this equally applies to systems operation. If a farmer is inefficient, that farmer could have produced more or higher quality food. So this is an intangible but real loss, because land is a limited resource. So I ask the question, should farmers be licensed? In the same way as during World War II, the opposite was the case, where food was rationed. Should farmers be licensed to ensure that operational efficiency is kept to a maximum in as far as that is possible? So the question I ask, and I'm not going to answer it, but I'm putting this question to you just to think about it, should virtual food loss be given equal consideration as tangible food losses? Meaning, if the farming system produces 70% of its potential, should that 30% be considered as a loss? We talk about 30% of food wasted. Is 30% of food production not achieved, hence in effect a virtual loss? I put this here to sort of instill a sort of an awareness of what may be coming in the future. This is from a university in the UK, Harper Adams University, which hosts the UK National Centre for Precision Farming. And it's just a glimpse of the future. Their website is indicated there at the bottom. But they have this vision of robots, small versions of tractors, looking somewhat like that, that they go out, they do all the work on the farm, but they are operating in a highly efficient way. And this whole system is pre-programmed, etc., with the ultimate objective of using these technologies to ensure high output, highly efficient operations. Another aspect of this is the AgroCycle marketplace, where we have developed a platform, what we describe as the Tinder for agri-food waste, because there's no such thing as no waste in terms of the agri-food sector. In effect, there are what we describe as unavoidable waste, which de facto are byproducts of the production process. And those should be utilized where appropriate. They're the waste that should feed a bioeconomy. But in order to have an efficient system, you need a marketplace in order to be able to trade those and ensure that you get suitable outlets for these produce, for this type of produce. So that's a key element in this. So finally, I have addressed a lot of issues briefly there. And in this schematic, I try to pull all these together, what I describe as the societal melee around the circular economy, food waste, and environmental impacts. Things like ill-thought-out policy, politics, a bandwagon effect. People think doing this is good, when in fact it may not be, due to some concept that has gained traction in the media, etc. The whole psychology of people, how they behave in life, market forces, education, lobbying, the Jevons effect, the citizen consumer lifestyle. And there is this thing, this is all very well, food waste is one of these things that is out there, but as long as it doesn't impact my lifestyle, everything is fine. So I summarize this to quote from Sir Walter Scott, "Oh, what a tangled web we weave." So in summary, my premise is that food waste has to be looked upon in a holistic sense. You have to address the full chain from farm production through processing to retail. And if you're building a bioeconomy, which is important on top of this, that bioeconomy needs to be fueled, as it were, by unavoidable waste. It is important that the bioeconomy does not in itself generate a market for waste arising from the agri-food sector, thereby reducing the perceived need for enhanced efficiency. So system efficiency is not driven essentially by technological aspects. It is driven primarily by policy and consumer behavior. Thank you very much. I hope that was of interest to you.
You present us a very useful consideration, and you clearly set the numerous challenges we have to face for the future. The warning you point out on the possible drift of the reuse of waste without challenging the behavior change is also very, very interesting. You raise also the main importance of education, and we can only agree. Really, you try to present the complexity of the situation we have to face and to think about how we can manage this at the level of society with every people, and also at the political level. This is a great complexity, but we have to think with this complexity and with this holistic approach. We are convinced of this. So thank you. I think we can see again your presentation and be inspired by all this.